entrepreneurs. Today we will discuss on changing federal structure and state politics in India. In the past few months, a debate has been noticed regarding the federalization process in India, as there are some scholars who argue that the process of federalization that was initiated during the coalition government era is turning back towards centralization, while there are some other scholars who feel that this is the era when the federalization is moving towards fiscal direction. So one thing is clear, that state politics is a very important thing to understand, and we find that in past few months, in past few time, the state politics is emerging as an autonomous discipline. As Professor Ashutosh Kumar has mentioned, that states are being recognized now as a primary unit of the analysis, and he also mentioned that earlier state politics was recognized as a sub-discipline of Indian government and politics, while state politics is getting a very important position due to its recognition of an autonomous discipline. This presentation is divided into two sections. First, we will try to understand the constitutional nature of federal structure, and then we will try to find out the emerging trends of state politics. According Article 1 of Indian Constitution, India is a union of states, and India has 28 states and 8 union territories at present. Here I would like to remind you one thing, that on 2nd June 2014, Telangana was included in Indian Union as the 29th state of India, but after the amalgamation of Jammu Kashmir into two union territories from 31st October 2019, we are 28 states. And one thing is also important to note, that after the merger of Dadra and Nagar Haveli with Daman and Diu from 26th January 2020, India has 28 states. So if we look at the constitutional structure, we find that federalism is a core point of Indian constitution. And in any kind of federal system, it is important to understand the division of power between center and state, because the power of division, or the power sharing formula, it decides the nature of the relation between center and state. So we find that in the 7th schedule of Indian Constitution, there is legislative power division, that is through union list 99 subjects, and through state list 69 subjects, and through concurrent list, which includes 52 subjects for jurisdiction, legislative jurisdiction of center and states. Then we move to administrative relations of center and state. We find that here are three main articles that define the shape of center-state relations. Here is Article 253. Which gives the power to center to make foreign treaties. Then here we find Article 256, which directs states to make their laws and administrative rules in compliance with the center. Then we find that there is Article 356, which gives center the power to dismiss the democratically elected state governments. And These articles are a soaring point between center and state in their relations. Then the third aspect is the financial relations. Here we find that the states are vertically dependent on center to meet their fiscal demands. So the financial relation is also a point of tension between center and state. If we look at the nature of Indian constitution, we find that there is a clear bias towards center, and even the word federalism has not been mentioned anywhere specifically in the Indian constitution. And this is the reason that the thinkers like K.C. Weir use the term quasi-federation to explain the nature of Indian federalism. If we try to understand that what was the reason for such kind of unitary federalism, we find that to manage the two extremes. What were these two extremes? The first extreme was the problem of unity and integrity of the country, as it was argued that a weak center is a detrimental threat to the unity of the country. Then we find on the other side, the immense diversity of the country demands the regional autonomy. So with this constitutional framework, it's necessary to understand the emerging trends of federal system. In the past three decades, the centralized federal polity has been replaced by a more decentralized and regionalized one. So, what is the reason for this change? We find that there are not any major constitutional change in the federal nature of the constitution, but the politics of states, they are the region that have reshaped the nature of Indian polity. So it's need to understand the various trends of state politics in a systematic way. So we can divide the various phases of federal polity into three categories mainly. The first may be the single party dominance and the centralized phase, and the second may be coalition government era and the decentralization phase, and the third may be post coalition era and the transition phase. So first we will concentrate on single party dominance and the centralization phase. We also categorize it into some sub eras. As first we will concentrate on the state politics in pre-independence era. So in the colonial India, we find that with the emergence of nationalism, a parallel feeling of regional consciousness was also growing, and a kind of identity politics was emerging. And there were pressure groups like Bengal Chamber of Commerce who demanded from Congress that in future India, the nature of federal polity should be based on linguistic states. And we also find that Congress gave its note, its consent for the this demand in principle. Then we shall focus to state politics in Nehruvian era. Initially, after the independence, we find that Congress and the Constituent Assembly took a U-turn for the linguistic reorganization of states. And we may find the region in the tragedy of partition. But again, we find another U-turn as On 1st October 1953, Andhra Pradesh was created as the first linguistic state of India. And the fulfillment of this demand opened the Pandora's box. And Nehru was forced to make a state's reorganization commission. And on the recommendation of this state reorganization commission, states of India were reorganized into 14 states and 6 union territories. So finally, we find that though it was a change of the Congress, but we find that the center-state relation was harmonious in this era, because in the center and in the state, the same party was ruling, and the chief ministers of the state were the big leaders of Congress, who had their own personality, and they were able to use autonomy in their respective states. Though we find some exceptions also, as the first Kerala government was dismissed, which was democratically elected first communist government in 1959, it was dismissed under Article 356 by the center on the charges of misuse of constitution and the failure of constitutional regime. So now we will focus to post-Nehru era. So here we find it has been defined as a dark age of Indian polity, because in this era, Article 356 was mostly misused, and it was used for 59 times. It was also an era when the dominance of Congress came to a halt. And in 1967 general elections, Congress was shown the door into many states. And in the during post-emergency era, when Janata Party came to power, it dismissed maximum state governments of Congress on the charges that they have lost the moral ground to rule. And again, we find that when Mrs. Gandhi stormed back in 1980, she returned the favor. The most important era is the coalition government era. This era is known for two major trends: the rise of states and emergence of fiscal federation. We find that India's first hung parliament was created in 1989, which ended the dominance of one party system. We also find that in this era, states and regional parties emerged as the main actors of politics, because they were sharing power with center on their own terms. They had a role in allocation of ministries, and they had a say in every important decision of central government. We also find that in this era, a bargain politics emerged. It was the most volatile and the opportunistic phase of Indian politics. Then we also find that due to rejuvenation of courts, especially Supreme Court's decision of Bombay case in 1994, we find a sharp fall in the misuse of Article 356. Another reason may be attributed for this, that the national parties were always on lookout for new regional elites. So they were wary of using Article 356 as they may lose their future regional partners. So this is the reason that the scholar like Douglas Verney used the term federalization to indicate the decentralization process of Indian polity. And we also find a new notion of divided government as the two sets of coalition parties were ruling the two sets of parliament, the two houses of parliament, and there were different parties in the center and the state. It also initiated a process of intergovernmental negotiation and mutual understanding in important decisions. Then we also find that in the very same time, initiation of 73rd and 74th constitutional amendments also contributed to the localization of politics, as the elections were more regular now and the fiscal allocation was more easy for local bodies from center as well as from state governance. Then the major trend that totally reshaped the federal polity, it may be attributed to emergence of fiscal federalism. Rudolf Schwab termed this era as federal market economy. The Indian economy that was earlier very centralized, and the industrial development and the investment was totally under strict control of center. It was now liberalized in 90s. So the markets were the new driver of growth for states, as the states had the option to explore markets for investment and to meet their fiscal demands. We also find that center was more reluctant now to allocate the fund to meet the gap of revenues between states. So in this era, we also find that on the one side, states were freed to attract more and more regional investments. On the other side, the regional disparity was growing across states. So we also find that the nature of this liberalization process, although it was not so interventionist, but the center was playing a regulatory role, and even today the liberalization process, it is under the regulation of state. So after the coalition government era, we should focus to post coalition era. With the 2014 general elections, a new trajectory is emerging, that while in the 1989 elections we found that it was an indicator of the one party dominance system, we find the 2014 elections announced the end of coalition government era. So what is the meaning of end of coalition government era? It means that the regional parties has less share in the governance now. And again we find that 2019 elections, it increased the process of end of coalition government era, and it opened the way to one party dominance. And we find that continuous deteriorating situation of Congress has made this process more easy. And we also find that the party competition is no longer concentrated along two alliances dominated by BJP and Congress, because the BJP is now able to manage the majority on its own in the Lok Sabha. So, here a debate emerges. Here are some scholars who argue that we are moving towards centralization process again, while there are some scholars who argue that we are moving towards more fiscal federalization. Sharma and Sweden have termed this era as modifying center-state relations era, and they mention the compelling reasons in their favor. So, we will look on the regions turn by turn. First, they have mentioned the proposals of BJP government to hold simultaneous general and state elections. Here we find a study done by Kochhar and Kumar and think tank IDFC. They gave a notion of unintended voting behavior. And according this study, there are 77% more chances that the voter will vote for the regional parties less than for national party more. Then also we find that the push of central government for one nation schemes like Ayushman Bharat and One Nation, One Ration Card, Yamini Ayer find that these are one size fits all central schemes which erases the spirit of federalism. While there is Louis Stillin who also mentioned that the One Nation schemes provides less electoral space to states for electoral credit. Then Sharma and Sweden again mention the unilateral nature of important decisions taken by central government, as the decision of lockdown and the decision of demonetization, that impacted the states badly. Then they mention some other regions like attempts to impose president's rule in Uttarakhand, in Arunachal Pradesh, and partition use of central agencies by ruling party like CBI for political vendetta, and the U-turn of center from its earlier commitment on GST compensation to states, and intra-party centralization of power, as we find that the PM office is gaining more and more power these days, and the Modi-centric election campaign in state assemblies, that are the regions that indicate that we are moving towards centralization. Even the use of term double engine in state assemblies by the BJP, it indicates the partition politics by the center. Then on the other hand, we find there are some other scholars who have their own arguments, that they say that it is the indication of more continuity than change in the nature of center-state relations. They give the three strong regions in their favor, as the speed up of liberalization process. As we all know that the recent Modi government has been branded as the more market friendly and more liberalization friendly government. We may see at the Ease of Doing Business Report 2020, and we find that India had jumped to 63rd ranking from its previous 77th position. Then we also find that the role of GST and GST Council is a big leap towards the federalization process. The GST gives poor states and consumer states more share in the revenue, and even the center has tried to manage the losses of manufacturing states by promising them to give compensation. Then we also find the binding report of 14th Finance Commission, which increased the share of states in taxes from 32 to 42%. And even we find that this hard economic era, the 15th Finance Commission had continued this divisible pool, though it has been reduced to 1% because of creation of Jammu Kashmir as a union territory. So there are other regions which may be mentioned as pro-federalized, in the favor of pro-federalized government, that the commitment of cooperative federalism by BJP in its manifesto, that it want to keep center-state relations on an even keel. And PM Modi, during his tenure as the Gujarat Chief Minister, himself had been a pioneer of state autonomy. Then we find that the growing fiscal federalism would check a stable return to center-based politics. Then we may conclude that the federal structure and state politics had seen many phases of transformation. The centralized federal model of Nehruvian and post-Nehruvian era has been converted into a decentralized regional model in during the coalition government era. And now in the post-coalition government time, we find that it is a transition phase, because there are some indications of political centralization that are less, and there is more indication of fiscal decentralization process. Thank you.